Hi, everybody. It's Monday morning, and this is Sally Talk Monday Morning. Monday Musings, I'm going to call it. If anybody has any other choices or other suggestions, I'd be welcome to hear them. It's funny having this one-sided with the podcast, so I'm getting used to it. When I worked in New York, there was a comedian I worked with, and he used to say, if you tell a joke and there's nobody there to laugh, is it funny? Well, what's nice is I do have like a little keyboard here, and I can, every time I say something I think is funny, I can do that, but I don't know if I'm going to do that. We all love that canned laughter, right? I'm old enough to remember when they used to do canned laughter during MASH, and they fought to get it removed. So anyway, I'm just going to do a couple, just some things that I'm thinking about and have that done on Mondays, because that's one of the reasons I wanted to start this podcast. So thanks so much for joining me. The weather looks like it's going to be nice here in California. We've been having so much crazy rain and storms, and I know we're big babies. Listen, I grew up outside of Buffalo from the time I was three, Buffalo, New York, from the time I was three until I was nine. And there are pictures of me and slides, of course, in a box somewhere, of me at the Niagara Falls when it froze over. So it's not like I didn't have a childhood with cold. I understand cold and I understand bad weather. I've just spoiled, rotten here in California. And I have checked the weather to see what the weather is going to be more in this last month than I have since I moved here in 1989. I mean, it's just been insane, because one minute it says it's going to rain, then it doesn't, then it rains later. And I'm at Boys and Girls Club in the afternoons working with children, and it really does make a difference whether it's going to rain or not, if we're inside or outside, because these kids are spoiled rotten as well for growing up in California. This is the most rain any of them have ever seen, so it's crazy. So I'm looking forward to it warming up and it being sunny this week, which will be nice. So I just got back from dropping off my son, my youngest son. He's at high school. And I used to love it back when they were younger. I could control things, you know, when they leave and everything. I used to either lie to them or just tell them we had to go, because I always wanted to get there about 10, 15 minutes early to avoid the whole drop-off gauntlet. And when you have a high schooler, you don't have that much control of what time they get up and when they're going. I mean, so we usually get there a little early, but today, for some reason, everything slowed way down. But what's really funny about it, when you really think about it, and I've been watching the clock, you're really only there for maybe 10 minutes tops, which is why I used to like to get there early, because the 10 minutes you're there, you know, if you're 10 minutes early, like, what's the bigger difference? What's the big difference getting up wise? You know, you're sleeping, you get up 10 minutes early. But if you're going through the drop off, it makes all the difference in the world to get there 10 minutes early. But today we were backed up in front of the high school, and there's two ways, you know, you pull in and you go up to the curb, and that's where you drop the kid off. And so there's two lanes, and the other lane is through traffic. So people are coming in and out of that curb. And there's always that one person who pulls up in the big whatever car, you know, the big navigator. They pull up and then they stop. And then they basically, you know, what are they doing? They sit there forever. They're like doing their taxes or something. I'm not sure what exactly they're doing. The kid's already gotten out and they're still sitting there. And if they would just move, it would make the flow go better. And then if you drop your kid off in that inside lane, in the lane not against the curb, then you could get a ticket for releasing your child into traffic or releasing your child from a moving vehicle. I forget which one it is, but that's a real thing. So you have to move over. So if that person pulls over and has, like, finally decides to have that, you know, in-depth conversation with their child about whatever, sex and drugs, this is not the time, because there, you need to move, you need to keep moving. But what makes me laugh, though, is that it's still only about 10 minutes that you have to deal with all of this stuff. People act like they're going to get stuck there forever, like they really do. They act like this is it. They're stuck and you're never going to move. I pulled up behind a guy. I was trying to get in past the walkway, you know, the crosswalk, and in to move up. And then I pulled up against the curb and he like thought I was too close or something. He was driving a Ford Flex. And I guess it was a new car and he didn't really understand how the vision in the back. And he actually got out of the car and was like, what are you doing? And I'm like, you can't. And I rolled down the window and I said, you can't move back in the Flex. You don't have enough room for the Flex to get out of here. No, I had given you plenty of room to get out. And he was just so discombobulated. But I think he really thought that I was never going to let him go, that we were going to be there till the end of time. I was going to block him in against the curb until the end of time. So he once he saw and he got out, I hope he was relieved. But anyway, the drop-off is always such the drama with kids. And I've been doing it for, you know, how many years now? 19 years, 18 years. My oldest is 23. I've been dropping off since preschool. And, you know, I've had to go through 3 schools. I've had to do the whole thing, get everybody up. Lunch is done and out the door and do all the drop-offs. So I do highly recommend. I was going to write a book called Just Leave the House 10 Minutes Early and your life would be so much better because traffic's better. Everything goes your way. You know, there's nobody's at the school. Everybody leaves at the same time. So if you leave 10 minutes early, you get there early. So there's my thoughts about drop-off. Weekend, on Saturday, I went with a couple of friends and it was very nice. I had a friend of mine invite me to a lecture or an author promoting his book. I guess that's how you call it, you know, when they come and talk about their book and be interviewed. And it was Robert Greene, and he's a very well-known author. He's written a lot of books, different books, and a lot of people in business like to read them. But they're also, but this one seems, I haven't read it yet because I was invited. It's called The Laws of Human Nature, and it's 600 pages. So, but I guess us human beings are, I guess we're kind of that interesting and we're that complicated. So maybe it should be more, right? But anyway, he was very, very interesting. And I thought a lot of the stuff that he said was fascinating. What was the main thing that I thought was really interesting was that he had had a stroke 6 months ago. And so he was definitely, we did a picture, and you know, there's a lot of social media with this kind of stuff. It was funny, we were standing outside and it was cold. I know I'm being a baby again with California weather, but it was cold. And mainly because we don't dress appropriately. That's the thing with Californians. We just don't dress right. So we always think, oh, the sun will come out and we'll be fine. But it was cold. So we were standing in line to get in. And they had us online for a long time to get in. And all of a sudden we saw the cameras were swooping back and forth. And they were doing all these things. And I realized, oh, I see. They're keeping us outside. So that looks like it's standing room only to see him for social media. It's crazy world we live in now, because when we were inside, we didn't necessarily, it was a big group, but we didn't necessarily fill the auditorium. So this way it looks like we're standing room only. I'm sure the author doesn't even know that's going on, but it's, you know, we all realized it. So anyway, when he got up to walk to the end of the stage to turn around, and then we all did a picture with us holding the books up. He obviously couldn't walk at all, walked very slowly. And with a cane and everything, and it kind of threw everybody. And so later in the lecture, or when he was speaking with us in the interview, he was telling us that he had had a stroke 6 months ago, and it was very similar to the one that Luke Perry, I guess, you know, it was a similar kind of situation, and that Luke Perry just wasn't found in time. And he was in the car, and his wife got him to, you know, the emergency room, and that basically saved his life. So it was an honor to be kind of in the presence with somebody who was obviously a very thoughtful man and someone who thinks about things very deeply, to also, you know, just have had this life event and how he was looking at things. So it was just kind of interesting talking about how, you know, things happen, there's suffering, and that the key to life was accepting life as it is. And I thought that was really, it was just really powerful, because it's just accepting it as it is right now and not always wanting it to be different. And I think that's a, you know, a big thing to remember, that we always are wishing things were different, or like me wishing that it was warmer, or wishing, you know, whatever. You're always wishing. So, have, you know, try and catch yourself wishing that things were better. He was also talking about how to like train your emotions, that your emotions and your emotional side of you is the more ancient side of you, and the thinking part is the younger version. But the thinking part can train the emotions, but it's hard work and you have to do it. So I was thinking about that with child raising. You know, if you let your child just go and run, it can get itself into harm's way. But so you have to kind of train a child. You have to discipline a child, and you have to give them boundaries. And so you have to do the same thing with your emotions. You have to kind of train your emotions and keep your emotions at bay and make sure you're asking yourself, is this really right? Am I really reacting properly? Because if you let your emotions run wild, it's usually not a good thing. But so I'm looking forward to reading the book. I thought it was interesting. He did say, I did look him up, and I always Wikipedia everybody. I always look everybody up. I always like to know things about them. And so it did. He was talking about, at one point he was talking about like looking at life like a child does in wonder, which I love that. And I agree with that, because children do look at things, you know, they look at cloud formations and they look at leaves and they look at, you know, birds, and they notice everything. And when you walk around with like a 5-year-old, you are so in the present, because they're looking at everything that's right around them right there, and everything's magic. And I work with boys and girls at the Boys and Girls Club in the afternoons. And, you know, the kids with the roly-polies, you know, they find the little bugs underneath the rocks, or they find just, you know, sticks, and they create things out of sticks. And it's really amazing. And so children really do a lot of, you know, they're remarkable how they are in the present and how they see things. But I did notice in his Wikipedia biography, he doesn't have any children. Now, I don't think that people who don't have children don't understand children. I'm not one of those people that thinks that if you aren't something, then you don't get something. And especially a thoughtful man like him. But it was funny, because it just made me think about how kids are. They're not always like that, you know. And it made me think about how people always say, you know, be honest like a child. And I just think about the kids at my club and how funny they are, you know, how selectively honest they are. You know, if you catch them doing something wrong, they're like, what? I didn't do that. No. Did you just hit, you know, Mickey? Did you just hit Mickey? No, his face was coming at me and my hand just happened to be up high, you know, or something like that. Like, no, I didn't leave that trash. I don't know where that trash came from. Or weren't you sitting there? Yeah, but I think it blew over from the wind, you know. So we get all of those kind of things, you know. And then, but yet they'll be really honest about some things, like, Sally, why do you have that big bump on your nose? And I'm like, I know, it's a mole. And they're like, why do you have it there? Why don't you take it off? And I'll go, I don't know, Kyle. You're the only one who notices it. Nobody in my life ever says, take that bump off your nose. So I forget about it. But thanks for reminding me that it's on my nose, you know? So you wonder, you know, if the kids are very, very, like, selectively honest. They're not, you know, necessarily 100% honest. So, but I do think that, I agree, and I thought it was interesting that since he's been through such a traumatic life event, that he was talking about looking at the life like a child. I do feel, because I kind of did that too. It was just, once you've gone through something, it jars you, and then you are kind of, you become more grateful for every day, and you become more looking at the world in wonder and seeing magical stuff. And it was great about talking about that, about living in other people's spirit. I thought that was cool. Like, that if, you know, with loved ones and with your children and with You should try and live inside their spirit. You should try and find what makes them tick and learn about them so that you can understand them. And so that the little stuff will fall away. All the little annoyances and things like that would fall away. So he was really great about that. But so I'm going to wrap up the last thing was that it was hilarious. So we're in the third row. It was cold, like I said, and it was cold in the auditorium. And this girl came in, and we were in the third row, and she sat in the first row, and she literally had a big pom-pom hat. She had a big hat with a huge pom-pom on the top of her head. I'll post it on my Facebook page. And when the thing started, and then you all get situated and you start looking where you need to look, it was just completely blocking my look to see Robert Greene speak. And she was sitting in the front row with a big pom-pom hat. And what was hilarious about it was that she kept nodding. So I had to move, because she was agreeing with everything he said. And she seemed to really nod when he talked about narcissism. Like that was really speaking to her. She was nodding and that pom-pom was just going back and forth. And I thought, I hate to break it to you, but if you're going to sit in the front row of an auditorium in a big pom-pom hat, you're a narcissist. So hopefully this is resonating with you and you will never wear a pom-pom hat again to a lecture. Or if so, you won't sit in the front row. So, all right, that's what I'm going to leave you with today. I wanted to keep this short. Thanks for tuning in. I'll be back on Friday with another episode of the grief series. But Mondays are going to be just something like this, what I feel like I want to talk about each Monday. So I hope everybody has a wonderful week. Thank you so much for tuning in. A lot of people have been tuning into my episodes, and I really appreciate it. And once I have 5, I get to go on iHeartRadio. So I'm looking forward to that. All right. Have a great week.